Thank you, everybody, for coming today. I appreciate the chance to share what I've done with OOCSS and SMACS with you all. And I hope that you, in turn, share what you've done so that we can all learn from one another. So today, I want to cover OOCSS and SMACS. So OOCSS is object-oriented CSS, and that was championed by Nicole Sullivan. And what does OOCSS mean? Oh, awesome. Well, she defines a CSS object is a repeating visual pattern which can be abstracted into an independent snippet of HTML, CSS, and possibly JavaScript. Once created, an object can be reused throughout a site. So does this sound kind of familiar? It sounds a lot like our components, doesn't it? So yes, we're familiar with objects. Some call it components. Nicole calls it objects. Right. There are two main principles of OOCSS, and they are: one is to separate structure and skin. So structure from skin. Oh, I don't have my phone with me. When I first read this, I was trying to find a way to make myself understand what this actually means. What is structure? What is skin? And I came up with, well, you know, my cell phone has a cover and I can change it out anytime I want. It's currently green, you can't see it right now, but it was currently green, but I can change it purple, change the pattern, stuff like that. And so I thought, hey, skin is kind of like that. Things that you can change out quickly and easily, while structure is something that remains consistent. Right. The second principle of OOCSS is to separate container and content. And once again, I was like thinking, how do I make this so that I can actually understand what is container, what's content, what is separating those two? And I thought about, hey, a container. Well, maybe you shouldn't lock yourself into a container. And like, don't lock your rules or styles into a container. So meaning don't use location-dependent styles. You want your object to look the same no matter where they are on the page. So don't lock yourself into, like, I'm going to be in the sidebar and I look this way in the sidebar, when all components should look the same if they're in the sidebar, if they're in the main body, if they're in the footer. Okay. Oops, whoops, you can't see most of that. But some of the objects already created by Nicole can be found there, and she has grid and she has the media object, and I wanted to show you the use of the media object, or how it can be used and why it's important to use objects, object-oriented CSS. So I'm gonna go log into Facebook. So what's the media object? The media object that was created by Nicole is, I'm going to draw over here, pardon me, is something like, so she calls this the media object and this the media object. And what it means is it contains either an image or link, and to the right of it is usually some text describing the image or some text describing the link. So this occurs a lot on the web, and it occurs a lot on Facebook. So what she did was she created this object, which is a div, and she gave it a class name of media. And then this was an anchor with a class name of image. And then this side could be of any type of block level element, like a div, with a class name of BD, meaning body. So the same over here could be the outer class is some container with a class of media. This is the anchor with a class of image, and this is some block level element with a class of BD. So if you take a look at Facebook, this could be considered a media object. This right here could be right here a media object. Over here, hey look, David Williams. This could be a media object. This could be a media object. This. So everywhere where there's an image with some description to the right, you replace that with the media object. Then you have one set of code to describe all of those places. Rather than, right now they currently have a class name for this, a class name for that, a class name for this, a class name for that. And everywhere they're defining this, the layout, three or four times, or five, six, right? So six times the amount of code to do something like that. Right? So that's the importance of objects in CSS, is you cut down on the amount of code and the duplication. Back to the presentation. So those are it. Those are the two main principles of OOCSS. Separate structure from skin and separate container from content. Okay, let's go. And I will show you some examples of what I did for Hermes for our project a little bit later. What I want to do is now move on to SMAX, which is Scalable and Modular Architecture for CSS. And this is written by Jonathan Snook. Okay. And it's really helpful for you to organize your CSS, because if you're using just one file and appending things to the bottom, it just gets unruly, right? You don't know where to look for things. So if your project doesn't have any organization, SMAX can help you out. Okay. And SMAX is more of a style guide than a framework. So you can't go online, download it, apply it to your project, and done. You're done, right? Everything's good and organized. It's more of a style guide, so you have to put it together yourself. Okay. So he has five basic categories for CSS. And for our project, we have it organized in a somewhat similar way, but then we also have a higher level ordering as well. And I'll show you that later. So the first category is base. Second category is layout. The third is module, the fourth is state, and the fifth is theme. And I'll go through each one of these, what these categories mean. So base rules are the defaults. Pretty much wherever an element falls on a page, it should look like this. So like you would want to target elements, like paragraphs or ordered lists or quotes or anything like that. You want everywhere where it appears, you want this base style. The second category is layout. And layout rules divide the page into sections, or they hold modules together. And here, you can use IDs, because normally you only have one header in a page, one footer in a page, one article, you know. Just things that are unique to a page, you can use IDs. So like an example is, normally an article would, you float it to the right, but then when in your layout flipped, the article floats left. third category of rules are modules. So modules are reusable parts of the design, callouts, sidebars, trays, and related children of modules. So if you have module and you have children inside the module, those related children can have the prefix of the module. Like say you have a box module. So and then inside it there's another container. You can call that box inner or something like that. So you prefix it with box. So you know that once you look at this rule or you look at the selector, you know it's part of the box module. So the module looks very much like a component. And also a module very much resembles an object in OOCSS. Oh dear, you can't see that. Okay, so the fourth category is state. You can't seem to see state. State describes how modules or layouts look in a particular state. It could be like hidden, it could be expanded, inactive or active. And some people think, hey, states can be classified like submodules. But the one distinction that he makes is that states are dependent on JS to make it change. So you need to say, hey, I'm off, I'm on, I'm active, I'm inactive, and that uses JavaScript to turn it on and off. And states are meant to stand alone. Usually a module or a page is in one state. It can't be in two states at once. And this is where you can actually use the bang important, because you might need to, when something is in the state of is hidden, you might have to override more specific rules. So this is where you can use bang important. But I haven't used this type of rule, so I'm not gonna dive much into it. You can read more about it in the book. It's actually if you have read it, it's pretty short and very readable. And finally, the last category of CSS is themes. And theme rules are similar to state, but they apply to the entire application. So most sites won't have this because we don't have themes. But you could, theoretically have, PayPal could have a Christmas theme. We could have a Valentine's theme. I know for one time we wanted to change our logo out, right? So you have like snow falling or something like that. But yeah, so themes apply to the whole application, while states apply to either the modules or sometimes just pages themselves. And I want to show you how we have organized the CSS for Hermes. I'm going to write again. I don't like red. So in Hermes, we have a base less file, and the base less files contain our grid, it contains our reset, and it contains our variables, I think something else. And then base is then imported into common. So this is how we organized the Hermes code. So base is included in common, base includes grid that we use everywhere. The reset that we use everywhere, the variables that we use everywhere. Oh, this also has our base classes as well, like the first category that I've mentioned. And I can show you guys that. How do I? Here. Oh, okay. One second, let me pull it over. So our base file, like I said, consists of variables, our mixins, our reset, our grid. So if you look at reset, Oh, did I just close it?
Nice.
You look at our reset, we have our reset files, reset rules, and then here, this is where we start our base rules. Like everywhere there's an A link, everywhere there's an A, it should have the color, this color. Right, so this is like the first category that he mentions is your base. And then the second category he mentioned is layout. So our layout is also included in base, but it's in grid. And this is where we define all of our layout rules. Then his third category is modules. And modules are sprinkled throughout, but most of our modules lie in common. So here's a start of one of our objects or components that's specific to our project. It's called the tray. So we have all of our rules for modules in a section. And then we don't have any state or any themes. So that's how we've organized it. So we do use, you know, some of SMAC's guidelines. But then on top of that, we have the whole base that's put into Common, and Common is used throughout the project. Okay, so let's go back to the presentation. And he also mentioned something about depth of applicability in the SMACS book. And I coined it DOA, because it's so much easier to say than depth of applicability. What does that mean? What does depth of applicability mean? Hold on a second. Back here. It's the number of generations that are affected by a given rule. So once again, it's the number of generations that are affected by a given rule. So let's say you have, crap, I didn't center that. Let's say you have this markup. You have a div with a class wrapper, and then inside of there's a class of content, and then there's a class intro, and then there's a paragraph with some content. I should probably write it again. So you have a wrapper div, a content div, an intro div, a P, some content, and there's some content. And your P, okay? So you have wrapper div, content div, intro div, and a paragraph with some content that wants to be styled differently. If you write your rule like this, wrapper has a child of content, has a child of intro, child of P, child B, do something with the B. What is your DOA number here? How many generations have you affected with this particular rule? One, two, three, four, five. Because it needs to traverse all of this to find that guy. So you have to look here, 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 here. Hey, I found it. How far have you gone? So that's five levels. So let's say you rewrite it to be, hey, it's wrapper. I want a wrapper. I want to find the P. I want to find the B. And you you do something with a B. What's the DOA number of this one? Your guess? Three? Your guess? Three? Mark?
Three.
Actually, it's five. With this, exactly. It still has to go through the exact same amount of generations to get to this B. Right. So your aim is to get your DOA number as low as possible. And the reason why is because you don't want to tie your rule to a specific HTML markup or structure. So the best thing probably is, hey, let's put a class name on that guy and target him. So your DOA would be then one. Applicability. And so this is kind of similar to separating the second principle of OOCSS is to separate the content from the container, right? You don't want to be bound by this markup just to get to the B. Okay, and that is all that I have for the presentation. So now I want to actually show you guys what I've done for the project. Okay. So if you go through the flow, you'll see something repeating, some visual pattern repeating over and over again. Okay, so what did you see that was like a visual pattern that was repeating over and over and over again? Did you see? Oh, sorry. Yeah. The container, right?
Yeah.
So I wanted to use that as an example. If we go back, see this container right here? It's a double container, right? It looks like a, and then if you, this one is also the same kind of thing. It has the same kind of gradient. It just doesn't have this inner, yeah. So what we call this was, we call this the tray. So the tray can have an outer tray, like in here, and it can have an outer tray and an inner tray. So if you go back, you can see the same thing here. There's an outer tray, inner tray, back again, another one, back again, another one. So it appears in so many places. And then there's a third variation of the tray here. Oops. So here's a different version of the tray as well. So there's a tray here. But the difference here is actually, if you look closely, it's going from dark to light. But here, it's going from light to dark. So there's three variations of this tray. So then I turn that into an object according to this. The OOCSS principles. Here's one version of the tray where it has the outer and the inner. Here's another one where it goes from light to dark. Was it light to dark? And this one goes from dark to light, the gradient. So what did I do? I did this. So we have a tray, tray inner. Here, let's go. This is the tray. This is the tray inner. Right. And remember the first principle of OOCSS. Separate the structure from the skin. So skins are the properties that will change. And then the structure are the properties that remain consistent. So, tray and tray inner are the properties that remain consistent. And then I have a tray inner, hold on here, tray default, and then tray inner default. And those are the skins of the tray and the tray inner. So does that make sense? So I have a tray default. Hold. Tray inner default. Hold. So here, so I have two classes on the outer container, two classes on the inner container. And the reason why is tray, all the structural, the things that stay the same are in there. All the properties in the tray default are the ones that can vary. And then tray inner are all the properties of the tray inner that remain the same. And then the tray inner default are all the properties that can change. Yes. So for this guy who's the inverse, I would have tray, right? Because I need that. And
which
then
gives you your margin and your height or whatever.
And then this is actually called tray inverse. Right. Versus tray default. Well, tray default here. Originally the markup was dot tray dot inner to describe my inner, but I decided against that because this could have the DNA number of being two or more.
So then what would be the benefit of having tray default?
Because, good question, you could essentially put all the default styles in here, right?
Right.
Right. But then that's inefficient. If you start looking at code, let's see, I wonder if I can find something that overrides. If you see something like all this code is crossed out to be overwritten, that means that's inefficient. Meaning I've painted once and now I have to repaint it over again. So rather than doing that, making it less inefficient, you can just pull this out, all the stuff, all the skin stuff, into its own class, and it only applies the style it needs. Once you don't have this and you apply this, it applies only the style it needs. It doesn't need to overwrite this. So when you see things overwriting each other, that's inefficient. That's this like, hey, I'm going to color this blue, now I'm going to color it red on top of it. Right? Why don't you just call it red to begin with? Thanks. So that's our tray component. We had another component and it's this component. We had a tip component. So if you see here, if I don't do anything, go back. See, I have an error tip. And then we had this guy. That's our suggestion. So we had that tool tip that I converted into a tip because I don't like being called tool tip. So I just turned it into tip because it's shorter. So I did the same thing with the tip component. I pretty much went through, okay, so what are the rules? What are the styles? Actually, what are the properties that will never change with this tip component? And what are the ones that change? And I pretty much did the same thing. So I have So this is what I ended up with. So there were 4 variations. So if you take a look, there's tip, tip arrow, tip arrow front, tip arrow back, tip text. So all those rules apply to all tip components. And then this is where you start getting the skin. So there's a tip hint, and then there's a tip error, there's tip description, yeah, and then I gave an example of how to use it. A tip, right, all the properties that remain the same. This is the skin of an error. So this one, all the properties that remain the same between both front and back arrows. This one is all the properties that are applied to the arrow, the front arrow, and then all the properties that can change for the front arrow. It's a little more wordy, but it's more efficient.
So the application of multiple classes is more efficient than the overriding?
That is my opinion. and you see this actually being used in Bootstrap, yeah. With their buttons. Yeah. There's button primer, yeah, stuff like that. I haven't done, I haven't personally sat down and looked at the performance. Yeah.
But for most of these things, we're talking about cacheable objects, so it's entirely okay if you're a little bit more verbose in the text side.
Right. Or, you're verbose here, but then your rules are actually more succinct. So you don't have to keep repeating, hey, this is the color, this is the font, this is whatever, right? You only apply what you need. And that's all I have for OOCSS and SMAX. Do you guys have any questions? Any comments? Right. So what you could possibly do is, so let's say you have the media object, media, and then there's an image class, and then there's a BD class, right? You can actually add another class here to describe, to be the skin, because this media is pretty much structural. So then you can add another class here to describe the skin, whatever changes that are particular to that media object. Yeah. So then you keep these, so you don't have to keep repeating these rules over and over again in your file. And And that's what they're doing right now. They repeat it over and over again, like 6-7 times. Anything else? How does it apply? I'm not sure. Let's see here. So separating structure from skin, right?
Yeah.
That was our first principle. And so structure and skin. So depending on your module, your structural properties and your skin properties differ, right? So not all, let's say, not all padding, like in one component, my padding remains the same all the time.
Mm-hmm.
But then another component, my padding actually changes so that it becomes a skin property rather than a structure property.
Interesting. So then the things that you typically think of, like box model attributes, like,
right,
don't apply.
I don't think so. Like, you can't say that all box model properties will forever fall under structure. I think it depends on the component that you create and what actually varies.
So it's like less structure, more implementational structure, right?
It's yeah,
like
so that's why I kind of didn't like the word structure, because you tend to think of structure more as the box model properties,
mm-hmm.
right? When I would rather have seen it like separate skin from like things that don't change in your component, some things that will change.
How granular do you get on some of those things? And have you figured out a place where it makes sense to go back to the rounded border thing? Let's say that they'll always have, or you know, a structural component would be that it will always have a border. It will always be 1 pixel.
Mm-hmm.
It will always have a radius of 5 pixels.
Okay.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
But the color
right.
might change.
Uh-huh,
right?
Uh-huh.
So then in your skin, do you apply the border color?
Sure.
Do you override that from the structure? Or do you...
Actually, that's a good question.
Out of
you actually leave it out of the structure.
Right, because then your DOA is less, right, on that
yeah.
one particular class.
So, like, you know that your border, what is it, border size? Is it border size? 1 pixel?
Yeah.
And then your border radius? Is that 5 pixels, maybe?
Mm-hmm.
Size, radius, style, border... solid? Let's see, D. And then over here, border color. Whatever. Red.
And that would be for like skin default. And
yeah.
And you would have skin blue.
Red, skin, exactly.
You would only swap out that one particular
yeah.
one.
Yeah.
It's interesting. I like
yeah.
that. I have a hard time with the concept of leaving, you know, applying it to a separate class as opposed to overriding
right.
it, because overriding it, that's what the C is for in the CSS, right? I mean, it's the cascading aspect of it. And so we're kind of removing that
mm-hmm.
cascadability and trying really hard to only apply the things
that are needed
when they're needed.
Yeah.
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 It's an interesting approach.
I would like to see actually what the performance is if you do override it, right? I mean, but this is just some, well,
and especially
these are concepts
of things, right?
Right.
Because if it requires like a full redraw, right?
Like perhaps gradients.
Yeah.
You know, like gradients, I would put all those into the skin
yeah.
and change it out, because that's kind of intensive to render
right.
gradients. And you don't want to render it once and then re-render it again, overriding it, essentially.
To see what types
yeah.
of things make more sense to become skin attributes
mm-hmm.
as opposed to, you know, because like maybe a border color is...
Mm-hmm. Right. Let's see.
Cool.
In the book Smax, Jonathan actually mentions he did a performance study with Steve Souders on CSS
mm-hmm.
and CSS selectors and how performant they were. And he found that this was actually in 2009 that between the best and the worst case scenarios, it's only like 50 milliseconds. So it's important, but don't worry. But don't worry about it, right? Like, it's like you should consider it, but don't waste your time on making like as fast as possible, because it's like less than 100 milliseconds difference. It's 50, right? But that was back in 2009. It might be faster now. So all this is to just make your code a little more scalable, understandable, rather than fast, because anything other than a single selector of class or ID is slow, right? Slow. 50 milliseconds slow. But yeah.
That's good. I mean, it makes you think more about the way that you organize your code, right?
Uh-huh.
It's not just about CSS. I think it's also sort of goes up into a more higher reaching thing, where if you're thinking about modularity of your code, you're thinking about, you know, properly componentizing things. It's good to know that the thoughts that go into
But here, let me actually, okay, so let's say you have a tip, right? And you have in there your border, whatever, your color, your gradient, and then you have tip override, if you wanted to write it.
Mm-hmm.
Override. Okay, there's another R over there. Override. And then you have, the only thing you have it probably is gradient, right? Let's say it's a gradient. So you repeated gradient,
right?
So let's see. If now you have tip, and then you have tip default. Let's see. You have your border, your color, your gradient. Maybe this is called something else. Yeah, override.
Gradient.
You add exactly. That's pretty insignificant for order, to maintain order,
mm-hmm.
Right? So you didn't gain much. You didn't lose much. But it's a little more organized. That's all I have. Thanks for listening. I hope you guys share with me.